Thank you. Yeah, it's working. Thank you very much for the introduction, and good morning, everybody. My name is Ulrich Leine, and I work and lead a research group at the Fraunhofer Heinrich Hertz Institute in Berlin. Most of you might know that Fraunhofer is the big association for applied research in Germany. And my topic I'll talk about today is evaluating motion and binocular parallax as deaf cues. But let me start with something more general. What do you think is the main difference between Germany and US regarding 3D technology? Well, I think your president is rather fine with the 3D classes, whereas our chancellor is not that happy to the same degree. So probably that is why I'm also concentrate my focus myself on other stereoscopic issues. And very quickly, we all know about a certain differentiation of the 3D displays. And what I will focus today is on two fuse and single user displays, because this kind of displays we used for our experiments. And before presenting the results of the experiments, let me quickly go a bit into the technology to present you and to lead you to the display type we used for it. And of course, we know that if we have a too few auto stereoscopic displays, it has some pros and cons. And of course, it provides higher resolution compared to a multi-view. You can add and realize more depth with it. But the problematic thing and the major restriction is that the sweet spot is very limited. And if you just move the head to the left or to the right, you see then the blue eye somehow seeing this, the green pixel and vice versa. And I already added a camera that should say, well, if you track the user, you have already at least the information. And if you use, if you exploit this information the right way, you may find a steering mechanism for the left and the right view and to follow, to make it follow the user's eyes. And I will give examples of this in a second. So what we have to do is to create and to close a feedback loop. You need a tracker for the eyes, and based on that, you need a technology to update the direction. But the challenge is this has to be done in less than 100 or even less than 100 milliseconds. And how can that be achieved? Well, first of all, you need a good and fast and reliable head tracking. And of course, there are several head trackers around. And I just present Frank, one of our team members, and he is trying to fool our quite robust tracker. And you see, it has to be fast. And well, to create and to implement it, a software that is tracking something is easy. The challenge for the tracking, the eye tracking, lies in the robustness. Robustness, for example, against skin color variations, if you wear glasses, if your haircut is not that standard. And okay, at least to a certain degree, we implemented and we realized a tracker that works, by the way, with two cameras if you need a very precise depth estimation, or with only one camera if it's sufficient to take the 65 millimeters as eye distance guess. Now, what could you do? Which technological elements are there in a 3D displays you could use for dynamization? We found basically that there are three of them. The first is you might control the backlight direction, but first for that you have to have a highly focused backlight at all. The second is you shift and scale the pixel content. And the third is move or switch somehow the beam splitter. So of course the the splitter might also be positioned somewhere between the backlight and the panel. But in general, this is, as far as we understood the problem, these are the options. And luckily, prototypes have been shown for all of these three in the research and even sometimes on the market. I just want to present one or two examples for each solution. The first is the reference to the project Muted. It is a typical European Union-funded project, and it even had the challenge to track more than one person at a time and to direct beams into 2x3 or 2x4 direction with a time-multiplexed, time-interleaved array with a laser projection. Details on request, also referring to the next-gen display from Serial, which also claims to have a very narrowly focused backlight that could be steered in a direction in real time. Second option is shifting and scaling the content. Well, basically it could be easy. If we come back to our depiction, then now even with a parallax barrier, that doesn't matter. You shift your head, now the green eye is seeing blue pixels, just counterbalance that by shifting the pixels. Looks easy, and we presented a display that is capable to do that. Toshiba recently announced one, I haven't seen it yet, unfortunately, and just not to complete, but just to add one more to the list, the company Seafront in Hamburg, Germany, has also one commercially available for some time. What is the challenge? It's not so easy to shift the pixels. You can't shift them in that discrete jumps pixel by pixel or subpixel by subpixel. You really have to go down to a sub-subpixel level of shifting content as smoothly as possible. And the third one is changes somehow dynamizing the beam splitter. A short reference to the Dynalux project, and then the presentation of the display we have developed and we have used in our experiments. This is a display with a vertical lenticular lens plate which is shifted mechanically. And of course, the crosstalk is very low. The resolution is just split by 2 of the native resolution of the panel. And the sweet spot, you see the stereo cameras, the sweet spot is enlarged to a reasonable range. And is it really possible to shift the lens plate in real time? Yes, it is. And that's the proof. That's how it's done, the construction. We shifted it to the left and to the right for the horizontal adjustment, and with these voice coil motors, forth and back for the distance adjustment. And since we had vertical lenses, we didn't need any vertical adjustment. Okay, and now coming back to the loop, we closed the loop by calculating the lens plate shift, by shifting it, and first applying that to a static image, but now I said I want to talk about motion parallax. Well, you could reuse the eye position for shifting the virtual camera for coupling the eye position with the virtual camera's viewpoint. And that was exactly the setup we used for our experiments. In my second part, I want to address the outcome of our tests directly. Well, we said we have a display and we are able to provide binocular and motion parallax in that display. And by the way, that to my knowledge, it was the first time that this was done without any glasses and without any markers. There is previous work on comparable studies, but most of them worked with glasses. Okay, and the hypothesis is if you combine the two cues, it's somehow better than each used separately. But what means somehow better? Well, first, we put quite a lot of emphasis into splitting these two depth cues under observation, namely binocular and motion, from all the other depth cues, which might somehow dilute the result. So you see, this pebble structure we used in the image, and it hardly has any textural gradients, no perspective, no shadows, tried really to eliminate all the other depth cues. And then we had a setup on the right side. You see the display with the test person. And then we had a setup that we used a fixed standard plane and a comparison plane. And this plane was visible only through a hole in the standard plane. So the person was somehow looking through it, had a frame like a passepartout, and then saw the comparison plane. And that one was moved. The setup was quite similar. We had 20 test person, and we had a standard plane in the distance of 20 plus 20, so protruding out of the display, minus 15 and minus 50 centimeters, and gave the questions with eye tracking used for binocular parallax only, eye tracking used for motion parallax only, and the combination. We then found out if you go for the monoscopic case, you even have to split that into a cyclops eye perspective. You give the perspective from a virtual point in the middle of the eyes, or you just use it for one eye only. But in the results, that didn't really matter. And the question we raised, can you see a difference in distance between the standard plane and the comparison plane? And with these questions, we went for the 50% threshold of people who said, yes, I can see a difference. I give you an example here. In binocular parallax only was active, and 36% of all subjects recognized the difference at a real difference of 0 dot something millimeters, and 58 if we increased it. So we calculated by interpolation a threshold of 0.93 millimeters, where half of the test crowd saw a difference. And here are the results. The results show that something that was well known before, that motion parallax is a much less precise, much weaker indicator for depth estimation, and it's approximately about 10 times better to go into the stereoscopic depth cues than use the motion parallax. And that confirmed results already been in the literature. But if you compare the results for the stereoscopic fixed and the stereo combination with the motion parallax, you have an improvement of roughly 20 to 30%. This is the overall scheme. You see the stereoscopic and the stereoscopic plus motion are quite close to each other. But if we zoom into this part, then we have only these two comparisons, and you see there is a gain of approximately 20 to 30, 40%. So this is a very precise outcome how a combination of both depth cues is superior and to which extent it's superior just using only one. And of course, we will see or think about that this advantage could be exploited, especially in applications where a very exact depth knowledge and perception is key. So that might be in medical application where you really know very close, you have to know the distance and the position, or in gaming. And I will close my talk with a presentation of this. Is it possible to show it on the screen. To a certain degree, yes, it is. We have this video, and the video will show how George Clooney is going to turn the avatar's head. And this to the lower right is the control monitor, and she is following. Of course, the motion parallax, it is much better to show in the video, but you will see by these artifacts that it's a stereoscopic, and by the double images that it's really a stereoscopic image. And of course, this is also a very nice fun factor, because you really have a very close to holographic impression. You hardly have any information, just the Virgin's accommodation conflict is not really solved by that setup. Okay, thanks for your patience, and thanks for listening. And all of you are welcome to visit us when coming to Berlin. Be our guest, be a partner of the Heinrich Hertz Institute.
Well, are there any questions? Gentleman back here on the aisle.
Hi. Did you measure, or did it have any effect, how far people were able to move to test the motion parallax? Were they moving just, did different subjects move their heads different amounts to, or is it only, were they, was their head fixed and it was only the motion parallax from?
I do not really know, since I haven't made the experiments, but the factor they were able to move the heads to the left and to the right was only limited by the angle of the detection cameras, and that allows about a movement of 50 to 60 centimeters.
And did they know that they were able to move their heads and that they were supposed to move their heads? In other words, did they move their heads when they were looking at the binocular only display as well?
Well, of course they tried, but then they noticed that, and there was a certain instruction.
Yeah.
But of course there was also the random sigmas of the test cases and so forth.
Is there another question? Okay.
Hi, thanks for your presentation. It's clear that nobody wants to wear glasses, but then of course everybody also wants a flying car, and people have been saying that autostereoscopic displays have been around the corner since the turn of the 20th century, even before they invented the regular car. So, I mean, the European governments have given, you know, tens of millions of euros for autostereoscopic glasses-free display, and I still don't have one, you still don't have one, so between you and me, when do you really think that we, you know, it's ready for prime time? When can I have this in my living room, you know? Yeah.
Be so kind and repeat the main issue. It was a bit difficult for me.
Oh, sorry, a little bit slower.
Yeah.
So there's been a lot of research on no glasses 3D.
That, yeah.
It's been very expensive, and it still doesn't work. Between you and me, when do you think I can go to Best Buy and buy a glasses-free television and enjoy stereoscopic content without glasses?
Okay, very general issue. Regarding these setups, maybe one answer is shifting pixels is less effort and less expensive than shifting lens plates. And this is the right direction. And we are currently working on displays which provide standard multi-view, and then you can switch to dual view. And on the market, well, there is one argument for me. If you have a two-view autostereoscopic display, all the content that is available for glasses will be immediately available for this kind of display as well. But regarding the market issue, I don't dare announce it.
Well, let us thank our speaker once more.